Hello everybody, GrayStillPlays, and I'm here with a very special guest. I'm here today with JC Baillie, who is the lead developer and as well as the president of Novaquark, which is the independent studio that is currently making a game called Dual Universe. JC, I just want to tell you, I really appreciate you coming here today, and I think it's very cool that you're here to kind of talk a little bit about this brand new game. And when a developer gets involved with the community in a way like this, I really appreciate that. So first off, just I really thank you for coming here today and taking your time.
Thank you, Gray. Thanks a lot for having me. I'm really happy to be able to talk about the game today. Thanks.
We're doing this from half a world away. As I understand it, you're way over in France. Is that correct?
That's correct. I'm in Paris in the morning having my coffee.
Okay. Well, very good. Before we start with just kind of like the real specific questions, we have a lot of questions from the community here. They're very interested about the game. This game has just very recently been revealed. And one of the things I just want to kind of get out of the way is, how would you describe this game to someone just learning about Dual Universe who's never heard of Dual Universe?
Yes, for sure. Well, Dual Universe is an upcoming sandbox sci-fi MMORPG. And it's focused on emergent gameplay and building. So everything you find in the game is going to be built by players themselves. If you see a city, a spaceship, or a space station, this is going to be built. There is voxel technology and all the tools to let you do that. And also all the, I would say, the social structures, like political structures, territory, social structures, all the things that you will experience with the community in the game, we also come from the players themselves. And all this, and that makes it really unique, I think, all this is taking place in what we call a continuous single shard. That means that everybody is going to be playing in the same universe at the same time. So there is one big server, there are no instances, no zones, no loading, no things like that. And everybody share this universe at the same time. And so there are a lot of things that can happen in terms of emergence. You see, things that happen because people interact with each other and they have different, you know, desires, different intentions, and they conflict or they cooperate. And so we find that really, really exciting to push this idea of emergent gameplay with this new technology that we have developed and allow new things to be done in this kind of universe.
Okay, so It's clearly planned to be massive, and that's very cool. And I like the fact that you're putting all of the responsibility in the player's hands when it kind of comes to how to shape the universe. That's pretty neat. For someone hearing about you for the first time, who are you? Who is JC? Let's hear a little bit about you real quick.
I'm a science guy, basically. I did a PhD in robotics and AI, so I did a lot of stuff on those domain. I created a company before Novaquark, which was called Ghostai, making robots and let's say a sort of operating system for robots. So there's no connection with video game from what I've done before, except perhaps the fact that I like, you know, technologies and complex systems, so I know how to do that. And I like to look, you know, at a domain and say, okay, what could we do that has not been done yet, that is made possible by the advances of new hardware or new bandwidth capabilities that we have today, or the cloud technologies, and how can we rethink the way things have been done so far, like in MMOs, for example. So I like to look at technologies and invent new things and then use these things to push the boundaries of what is possible a bit further. So that's the link. But, you know, basically my background is in AI and robotics and complex systems. And I like also emergent systems. You know, in AI, I was interested in emergence. So we're not going to talk about that. It's a whole topic to discuss if you want. But about having, you know, small bricks that you assemble that will actually together give birth to interesting evolving systems, right? This is the same idea that we have in Dual Universe.
Okay, so let me ask you this. Are you a gamer? What kind of inspirations did you have for the thoughts process and the creation of Dual Universe?
Yeah, I'm a gamer. I played a lot EVE Online, for example. I played a lot of Minecraft. I guess I like games where you can be completely immersed into something that is that you feel is realistic, where you feel you have a lot of freedom where you feel you might be surprised by things that you don't expect. So hence, for example, all this idea about emergent content that comes from the players. If I go on a planet and I land on it, I want to be surprised by what I could see on it, because it's made by other guys, other people, and I don't know what's going to be. You know, there could be a new city that I've never seen before that is completely original. So I'm interested in that. And I'm interested also in having everybody in the same world at the same time, something that you have also in EVE Online, because they are a single shot. But I want to push this a step further, having people, you know, the capability for people to build stuff together, to create things that are gigantic, surprising, astonishing. So I want to be surprised when I play a video game.
Okay, so what about like the project origins for Dual Universe? What can you tell us about those?
Well, the origin is somewhere in the summer of 2011. And as I said, I was playing EVE Online, I was playing Minecraft, and I thought it would be really cool if we could get those two concepts together. So a single shard world where people can actually build stuff. So that was the beginning, and I started to think about it. And I wrote a lot of text, a lot of thinking and brainstorming. And at some point, I realized, you know, that the technologies were ready. I mean, the bandwidth, the cloud technologies, what I explained already. I did some prototyping to set up what we call, you know, this continuous single shard technology to allow everybody to be present in the game at the same time. And I made some testing. It worked. And then I decided to create the company. So the thing is that I had already investors that were following me from my previous venture that were willing to actually support me into financing the early stages of the company. This is important to understand that we are completely independent because of that. So we have been able to finance the beginning, hiring the first engineers, and getting the first prototypes that basically we have seen in the videos we published. So that's the origin of the project. It started in my head in 2011, and as a company, it started in 2014.
Okay, great.
Early in January, basically.
Nice. Okay, so this has been going around for a little bit then. This is something you've been working on. So we're going to start just getting into some of the questions more about the game, getting into a little bit of more specific stuff here, especially some questions from the community. I wanted to start off with this one. I imagine this is going to be on a lot of people's minds. How is player death handled in the game?
Oh, yeah. This is a crucial question for MMO, right? So there won't be permadeath, quite obviously. That would be too punishing. So basically, when you die, you respawn. You respawn in a place that we call a resurrection node. So it's something that you can craft yourself and then put anywhere you want yourself. And the rule will be you resurrect in the closest resurrection node that is from the place where you died. So you cannot select, otherwise you would use that to teleport yourself, right? So little things like that are important so the game doesn't break. So the point is when you die, you resurrect in these resurrection nodes. It's very interesting because it will make those nodes very important and strategic things to protect, to hide, maybe 500 meters on the ground, who knows. And also as a military target, it will be something essential. If you're attacked by a fleet that arrives from a long distance from the original system and attacks you, if they didn't bring some resurrection nodes with them, you might actually send them back home by just killing them, right? So you see that the implications of what this brings in terms of emergent gameplay is very exciting. We don't have specific places where you're going to be reborn. Now, that being said, I have to say that I'm talking on the vision of the game, what we want to have, hopefully for the release, which is going to be maybe in 2018, that's the plan. So just to make it clear for people listening, I'm talking about the intentions of the things we want to do. There's a difference between that and what we are going to have in Alpha.
Correct.
Where we are going to simplify things. It takes a lot of time, a lot of money to do this. So we have to go progressively. About the resurrection nodes, for example, it's very likely that we will not have this system implemented at the alpha stage because we have to make choices. And At the alpha stage, you will simply respawn at the Ark ship, which is the ship that brought you to this planet with the other people, and is the origin ship where you step out when you enter the game. So to simplify, at the beginning, you just respawn at the Ark ship, but later on, you will be able to select, to position nodes where you will be able to resurrect yourself.
Got it. Okay. So what would you say, now obviously, like you said, the players have a lot of different ability, you know, just a lot of different abilities and things that they can do. It's emergent gameplay. What would you say, like, the goal of the game is? Does it vary from person to person? Is there an overarching goal that people are looking to complete?
The short answer is no. The idea is that this game is emergent. So, we may have a few quests or things like that that will play like tutorials, like things, you know, but maybe even not that. We are not sure. But the core idea is that the things you experience, the things you live, come from yourself and the other players. So the goal of the game is driven by the players themselves. And there will be very different goals depending on different people wanting different things. Some people will want to build industrial empire. Some people will want to have power and control, a large military force and control some parts of the galaxy. Some of the people would just like to explore as a lone wolf, and so on and so on. I mean, there are a lot of what I would call, gamers' dreams, that you can dream. You enter this game and you dream about who you're going to be. So you could be a pirate, you could be a politician, you could be an explorer, a fighter, et cetera, et cetera. So that will set for yourself different types of goals, right? And
right.
If you don't have any specific desire, the idea is that other people may have plans. Let's take an example, right? Let's say someone wants to build a Death Star. I'm pretty sure someone will want to do that at some point.
That's right? Probably on a lot of people's minds, yeah.
That's right, that's right. Especially since you can actually build very huge stuff. We may talk about that a bit later if you want. But anyway, someone wants to build the Death Star. It's not something he can do alone. There's too much materials to gather, too much planning to organize, too much logistics. You have to defend the building sites. You have to hire mercenaries. I mean, it's a huge enterprise. And that would actually occupy possibly thousands of players involved indirectly into the quest of building a Death Star. So as you enter the game, you might just look at what jobs are available currently in the game, who is offering what kind of jobs to do what, and you select what you like and what you want. You may find it interesting to contribute to the building of the Death Star. So you just do that. So instead of having the developers setting quests that will give you goals, we let the players, perhaps some of them, the more active players, create quests for others. And they are genuine quests. They are real. They matter because they are from the players themselves. So it's very different. There are not only one goal. Right, there would be several types of goals.
So very flexible, just a large flexible system where people can kind of be and do what they want.
That's the idea. Sometimes I want to call this game the ultimate dreaming machine.
Okay.
You get into the game and you dream, who do I want to be? What can I? That's something I really I enjoy a lot in gaming in general, when I can actually picture myself becoming something, taking a role. Actually, it's role-playing game, right? That's the name.
Right.
So that's all what this is about, actually.
The game itself having this kind of flexibility, what can you tell us about how an economy would work?
Yeah, that's a very important point, because the economy will be the central hub that will directly or indirectly connect every player. If you mine some resources, even if you're a lone player, you don't want to interact with others, you're kind of single playing the thing, you're mining resources to make money, you sell those resources on the markets, and the people who are buying those resources are doing something with it. Like, for example, they're doing the Death Star, right? So you're contributing to the Death Star even so you don't even know it. So the economy is a central hub. And the way we want it to work is to be very realistic, in the sense that markets are based on the way Wall Street is working. You have a buy order, sell orders, and then through the pressure of supply and demand, there is an equilibrium that builds that sets the right price for the asset. The right price is what the market says about it, right? So we don't have preset prices for anything. If more people want something and there is a limited amount of it, the price will go up. That's simple.
Okay.
So the economy will be based on that. And unlike other games, the places where you will have a market is again decided by the players themselves. Anyone can actually create a market anywhere if he has the resources and the money, etc. There will be some costs with that, of course, but you can create a market. And if it becomes successful, it might become a huge hub of economy in the game where people actually go. Because the last point, and I conclude on that, is that things do not teleport magically into your inventory. If you buy a ship, for example, on a remote market that is far away, maybe on another planet, right? You will have to actually travel there to get your ship.
Ah.
When you buy it, your ship, it's yours. It's there in the market containers or in the garage. It will be waiting for you. You bought it, fine. But it's not, I mean, you have to go and get it, or you have to pay someone to actually convey it to you. So there will be logisticians, people, you know, dealing with moving stuff around. But so that makes a big difference, because then markets will have specialization and localization, or you could have a market in a remote area that is at war, maybe. And you will actually profit from taking the risk to bring materials and assets to this market through the war zone, so that people can buy it from there instead of having to go, you know, back and forth to a more popular market. So it will make a very interesting emergent gameplay again about managing the markets, managing the economy.
That's pretty cool. So you can literally be a trader, or almost like a smuggling or a cargo style of ship.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Right. Yes. Yes. And to some extent, some players will be able to do trading sitting in their home, in their stations, or wherever they want to sit, with very powerful and if they're skilled enough, their trading skills, they will be able to trade from home and just buy stuff and sell them. They won't even go and pick them. They will just buy them and resell them a bit later. And so this is a pure trading activity for people who want to make money in the game.
Dual universe utilizing voxel technology. What can you tell us a little bit about voxels? What can be done with them?
Okay, well, this is also a quite unique feature. I think that there's just a few games, and definitely not in the range of massively multiplayer games, that allow you to do what we do, which is basically that you can shape anything you want. Think of it as a sculpting tool. You can take matter that you acquire either through mining or by finding it on the market, and you can then put this matter into shape with the voxel technology. So the basic shapes are, of course, there are cubes or spheres or things like that. We will gradually add more and more tools for people to be able to literally carve stuff and cut things and smooth things and so on, so that you can really create things the way you like. So this is one aspect of what we call building, which is about, you know, positioning the structure, the shape of things. There will be also, and this has nothing to do with voxels, there will be also elements which are predefined meshes, actually, so that you cannot modify those things. They are predefined by us. And they bring some functionalities, like an engine or a radar or a cockpit or a weapon, etc., etc., etc. There will be a lot of those things. And those elements you can actually put on the shape structure that I just mentioned before, so that you position them where you want, and then you connect them, and then you script them. So we may discuss about that a bit later if you want. But the idea is that building a ship involves basically two stages. One, which is to sculpt the shape of the ship with the hull and all those things, carefully choosing the materials, by the way, about their weight, about their resistance, about all sorts of things that will make it an interesting engineering activity for people who like that. And the second phase is to put the elements on it so that it gets some functionality. So it can actually move, it has engines, it has weapons, it has cargo bays if you want to transport things, and so on and so on. So this is how it's going to work. And on the voxel side, so there will be basically two types of voxel activities, those that you do on the planet which is mostly about mining stuff, so taking things out of the planet. Even so, you can also put things on the planet, so you can do the opposite operation, right? You can collect materials or deploy materials. But for that, you will have a lower resolution of probably something like 1 meter. So the size of the underlying grid will be about 1 meter. For the voxels that you use on your ship, so you create a sort of a local voxel grid, if you want, when you initiate the construction of a ship, which is done with a core unit. When you do that, you have a 25 centimeter resolution. So it's much more precise. You can do much more beautiful and detailed things. So that's about it, about the voxel at the moment.
Okay. You were saying something about scripting. As I understand, there's something called LUA scripting. Someone who's never heard of that, how would you kind of describe that?
Okay. So first of all, I want to say for people who don't like to script or don't want to know about that, that they won't have to. So this is something that will be for players who have a little bit of background in programming. I mean, LUA is a scripting language which is very easy to learn, and it's really easy to use. But for people who are not interested, let me just say talk about that first. The thing is that you will be able to buy a ship that works from the market. So you don't have to be interested or able to build, to craft, to do scripting or anything. You can just buy a ship on the market, and that's it, and it works. And by the way, you pick the one you really like, so there's competition, and only the best ships are going to be selected, and so on and so on. Now, for people who are more into fine-tuning the programming of the ship, yes, there is Lua scripting. So what does it mean? It just means that when you have elements on your ship, right, they offer certain capabilities. That's why they are functions. You know, they have like an engine can activate its power, or radar can send you information about what's around you, or weapon can fire, right? So each of these possibilities will be displayed in the Lua scripting as what we call a method or a function of an object. The object is going to be reflecting the element, and the function is reflecting what the element can do. So scripting will be about writing little programs that say, when I press a certain key, which is an event that you can catch in the Lua architecture we will have. When I press a certain key, I want a certain engine to activate with a certain value, right? So that will actually start your engine when you press the key. That's the basic idea about how this is going to be happening. So there will be events triggered by you moving the mouse or pressing certain buttons, but also certain elements will be able to emit events, like a radar will tell you that something is happening, some ship is showing up, etc. So you will be able to use these events to trigger some reaction from your construct based on Lua that makes the glue between those two things. Now, if you don't want to, I mean, suppose you have built a nice ship and there are engines at the right places, it should actually work, you're happy with that. You don't necessarily have to go in Lua to script the way the engines are going to be activated, because we actually already have something that is called the auto configurator that will look at your ship and write the Lua code for you that does the normal thing you expect from the ship. So only people who really want to go into making some very advanced movements or maneuvers of the ship, they will be able to dig into the Lua scripting to do these kind of things. And if their thing is really cool, they can make a blueprint of this ship plus the Lua scripting. And this blueprint, they can use it to make copies of the ship and sell it on the market. So everybody can actually enjoy the efforts they've put into making this nice ship plus scripting. And of course, the guy profits from that because he sells that on the market. So there's an incentive also to do this for the builder.
So essentially, it's giving players like this very deep extra level of customization for their structure, their item.
That's right. The core idea is that you don't need everybody to be able to use that deep layer for interesting content to emerge for everybody else. If you have something like a market that can spread the innovations, literally, I mean, we're talking about an economy with innovation in it, right? So if you have a market that can spread that in the community, you have everybody benefiting from it. So you don't need everybody to be an expert in shipbuilding, in scripting, etc. It's all about specialization. That's the core idea. And if you think about economy, that's what it is about. I presume you don't know how to build a car. Right? I don't know how to build a car.
Sure.
But you have other, but you have other talents that allows you to make money. And with that money, you can buy your car. So that's the same idea. We don't expect everybody to be an expert in Lua scripting or even building ships and so on. This is a very important point.
Okay. So territories within the game, how will territories work?
This is another important point. territory is closely linked to what we call the right and duty management system. So it's all about, you know, how you'll be able to say for a given asset, who has the right to use it, who has the right to sell it, who has the right to benefit from it. So I won't go into details because it would be a bit long, but the idea of a territory is that it's a land asset. And once you own a territory, which is basically something like a 1 kilometer radius area on a planet, you have the right to set the permissions for other peoples to mine this territory or to start building things on it, like having a house or something built on this territory. You may also set entry rights, who has the right to enter the territory. It's not set yet whether this will be a strong, you know, impossibility for people to enter the territory, or if they will just be flagged as outlaw if they enter, even if they don't have the right. So this is still in discussion. But the idea of a territory is that you get control on a land asset. And to do that, you will have to actually plant what is called a territory unit into this tile, basically, of space on the planet. And if you do that, then you acquire the territory. Of course, people can actually take it back from you, so they can attack this territory unit, they can hack it, and they can take control of the territory if you don't protect it enough. So this is the rough idea about territories, and it will extend into space later. We have not yet decided exactly how this is going to be organized, but to start with, territories will be on the planet. So the planet will be, you know, covered into hexagons, you know, and we actually there will be several pentagons, because as you know, you cannot cover a whole sphere with hexagons, but that's a detail. Mostly there will be hexagons on the surface of the planet, and you can acquire those hexagons by putting a territory unit on them.
Okay.
That's the idea.
So we've kind of been asking questions shaping the game here. Something that I think people are interested in is, like, you know, the lore of Dual Universe. As I understand, there's a short story taking place with inside of Dual Universe. What can you tell us about any kind of, like, story or lore of Dual Universe?
Yeah, we had a short story written by Alain Damasio, who is a very famous French writer who has written sci-fi and fantasy books that are a great success here in France. So we were super happy and pleased to have Alain with us. And the point is to actually give a bit of context so that you arrive. So what's the lore? I mean, what's the backstory, basically? It's very classic. It's not very original. The Earth is going to be destroyed because we spotted a neutron star arriving through the galaxy.
Poor Earth.
yeah, and that's bad news. And we have like 500 years to prepare an evacuation plan. So we have some ARC ships, as we call them, to actually get as much people out of this planet and try to rebuild civilization together on another planet somewhere else. So we embark on a 10,000 years journey in cryosleep to actually get to this other planet. So that's the basic starting point. And when you arrive with this ARC ship, you're taken out of cryosleep and you start with a completely empty world. Well, I mean, not empty, I mean, it's just that it's just nature and you have to rebuild everything from scratch. So that's the backstory. It's very, you know, classic. There's nothing special. But then in the short story of Alain, he is describing What happens to one of those guys who just wakes up? The pain goes through because, you know, 10,000 years in sleeping, in the cryo sleep, it's very demanding. And so what experience personally on that is very well written. I really recommend people to go on the dev blog or on the webpage at duelofthegame.com. If you go, you will see there is media with the novel, short story, sorry, that you can read. So it gives a bit of context, and we hope that people will start from there to actually build fan stories and invent things that give flesh to this universe. But the second part of the lore, which is what happens when the Ark ships have landed, is going to be written by the players themselves. That's the idea.
Okay.
There are other things that I think it's too soon to talk about them right now, but we're going to work on more about the lore. I mean, I cannot say yet. I would like to, but I mean, there will be things to discover in this universe. There will be things to understand, and there is a much bigger story actually going on that we will reveal, or that actually players will understand as they progress. But the trick is that we want to make it so that it can last for several years. Right? It has to be a big thing so that you understand progressively. This is difficult to do, that it's not too obvious that people get it right away. So we're working on that. We would like to make that.
Okay, so now I want to get into some of these. Now, these are some of the fun questions about the game, just kind of the limits and things of that nature. And this question here had probably been asked. Everyone really wanted me to make sure I got this one, because I think I had been asked this one about five different ways. How big can the ships become? People have asked this in so many different ways. Can they become planet-sized? Can they become moon-sized, Death Star-sized? How big?
Okay, so I have good news.
Okay.
There is no technical limit to the size of the ships, because technically a planet and a ship are exactly the same thing in our technology. So we don't have any specific way to display ships. If you look at the planets in our videos, they display, as you see, very well, even in a distance or close by. And it's the same technology to display the spaceships or the orbital station and things. Now, the real question is not how big technologically we can display things, is how much time it will take people to build it.
Right.
And I think that is the real limitation, because there will be no shortcut. I mean, you cannot just say, okay, let's build a 10 kilometers long wall. No, you will have to build it, and you will have to gather friends, and you will have to organize how to get the resources to do that. You will have to buy them on the markets. You will have to have a lot of people mining those things and so on. So I think you have a similar question that we may discuss afterwards about the size of the universe. The thing is, the limit will be how much players are willing to invest into making these things. But technically, the ships can be as big as you want. The other limitations is if you want your ship to move, you have a problem, which is that the physics is real. So if you want something to move, you need to put the corresponding thrusters and engines so that this thing can move, right? So we have in mind things that are like the Titan engines that would be like Titanic size, huge monster things. But in our simulations, the huge space station that you've seen in the video would need like, I think, 26 of those Titan engines to just move very slowly. Because it's real, because it has a huge mass, because you need to put a lot of force so that you get decent acceleration when you have a lot of mass. You know, so force equal mass per acceleration.
So there's a little bit of science to this as well.
Yeah. I love science. As I said, you know, I'm a science guy. I got a training in science and also in physics. So I really enjoy that. Now, also at the same time, we want this to be fun, so you don't need to come from NASA to be able to do this. Even though, you know, for example, I love also Kerbal Space Program, but we will try to make it a bit more accessible, because it's not the only point of the game to actually design control technology for spacecraft. But anyway, there will be realistic physics in the sense that things that are heavy need a lot of power to move. So this might also be a limitation on how big ships can be.
Okay, great. Well, yeah, I was a couple credits shy of my NASA degree, so I'm glad that, you don't need that sort of knowledge to be able to perform well. Let me ask you this, though. You're talking about universe size and that sort of thing. How big is the game to, like, a real-life scale? And this question has been asked, like, you know, how big can the planets get? The distance between planets, solar system size, what can you say about that?
Yeah, So far, the planets are 100 kilometers radius, the biggest one, the one you saw in the videos. We are not sure we should go much further in size for the planets, because simply we want these to be not completely empty. We want people to actually be able to have a grasp of the size of it, visually see, you know, things that recognize a city here and things like that. If the planet would be big like the Earth, I mean, the Earth is gigantic if you think about it. So you basically see nothing from space, as you don't see really cities, except in the night, of course, but you don't see cities from space. They're just too small. So this is something we've been thinking a lot about, trying to find the right size of the planets. And by the way, also finding ways to get players to actually have a reason to gather and build cities rather than spread and be independently living their lives. Markets will play a big role in that, obviously, because as I said, they are physically localized and so on, everything I explained before. Now there's another question that maybe is contained in what you just asked, is, you know, how many planets will there be? How big is the universe? And the answer is, there's no limit to how big we can make the universe. This is procedurally generated. That means that there's a mathematical function that generates those planets. So they are basically free to create. We could have 10 billions of trillions of billions of planets if that matters for people to hear. But the point is that in this game, and it's a bit like what I said about the size of the construct, getting to a distant part of the universe will involve you creating a sort of a probe that will physically travel over there so that it can deploy a seed of a stargate that you can use once to jump there and start to build a stargate that will actually be something you can use to go there in one jump instantly. But it will take time to actually build this first stargate to the distant system. And then once you've done that, you will start another set of probes to go a bit further, and that will take also a real life time. We're thinking about having the probes taking between 1 week and perhaps even 2 months to actually get to another solar system. So again, here the answer is that the size of the universe can be as big as you like, but in practice, the time it will take for people to explore this universe and to create a network of stargates and to create the relevant markets and to have the relevant economic structures deploy into this area, it will take time. And this is what will decide of the size of the universe. How many players and how much time they have invested into exploring this world.
Okay, so if you want to be a hermit and stay as far away from civilization as possible, you'll definitely have that option.
You have that option, but you have to think that, keep in mind that if you want to be a hermit, if you have certain needs, you may have to do everything by yourself, which may take a huge amount of time.
Right.
So you will need a market so that you can use other players' specialization for your own benefit. And so you can be an hermit, but at least from time to time, you will have to travel back to the civilized world to, you know, to do your groceries, basically, get back where you want. So this is important to understand. The size of the universe will be decided by how far people are willing to explore. And by the way, there's a consequence, I think, which is that when you arrive in a certain area of this universe that has been explored because you used a stargate to get there, there's a good chance that, you know, this target has not been made for no reason. There's probably some interesting materials to mine in this area. So there have been at least mining outposts that have been developed. There are things going on. So when you arrive in a certain area of the universe, there is a chance that you will discover things made by other players. It's interesting. It's not just randomly or empty content that you will explore. It's something that probably comes from players. And personally, I find that very, very exciting.
There's a question here from the community that deals specifically with those Stargate probes. It says, do star systems exist before Stargate probes are sent to them, or do Stargate probes create star systems within the game engine?
Well, we probably have the stars already exist in the sense that you will probably be able to scan them to have an idea of what is there, or at least scan the sun, the type of sun that is in this system, so that you can make educated guesses about the kind of materials that you may find on the planets orbiting this sun, so that you don't spawn a Stargate randomly anywhere. You have a certain reason to go in a certain area of the universe. So that means that to some extent, you will be able to analyze and look at the different things that exist already. Now, of course, nothing will be created on the server. Nothing will be, you know, instantiated until somebody goes there. This is just elementary optimization of, you know, the space and the resources that we have.
This question here, we were talking about earlier, just you and I, about kind of the underrepresentation of the space genre in these types of games. Recently, we've been having quite a few space games coming out. What makes Dual Universe stand out in your mind from the other recent space games coming out lately? Kind of what does it bring to the table uniquely?
That's a very good question. The thing is that I believe many aspects of our gameplay, let's say, for example, building, you will find in other games that have somehow specialized in that aspect. What you have in Dual Universe that is unique is that we have all these different aspects like exploration, building, politics, that are all put together into one single game. And the big difference is that we are a real MMO, a massively multiplayer online game. We have the thing I mentioned, which is the continuous single shot, that means that everybody is playing in the same world at the same time, and they can interact with each other, and they can build cities, and this changes everything. Because, well, let's say Minecraft, okay, you build a wonderful castle in Minecraft, or a spectacular spaceship in Minecraft, but it doesn't move anyway, but let's say you've built something great. You're going to show it to your friends, you're going to make a video on YouTube, maybe, and that's it. Now, if you have made a beautiful castle and this becomes actually the imperial palace of a huge empire in a real, I would say, a real world, a real virtual world where there are lots of people involved, where there are political intrigues, where things matter, where you have struggles, where, you know, this changes everything. This construction that you've made acquires meaning because it's part of this collective story. So I don't know how to stress that enough, that, you know, the aspect of having a unique universe, a universe shared by everybody, that is a single shard that everybody can live in at the same time, is changing everything profoundly in the kind of games experience you have. Even though you may think, you know, that the particular feature, the particular aspect of gaming, you may find it in some other games, but because it's part of a continuous single shard, it changes everything.
Okay, so talking about, you know, the size of the game and how it is massive in multiplayer, this one here says, how will you be able to find your friends inside of the game?
Okay, so either you know your friends and you know their names, so you can find them, but I guess the question is, how do you make new friends? And the answer will be through what is usually called a guild, but we call it an organization. So group of players that gather and that set themselves a goal. You know, we want to be pirates, we want to be a pacific organization, we want to be smugglers, etc., etc. So the thing is that these people, this organization, they will actually be able to open and promote jobs and open positions on sort of a job market, something that you will be able to explore as a new player to see what kind of things are available in terms of, you know, type of gameplay, type of role play offered by this organization. So we will try to make it, it's very important and it's hard to make it right. We'll try to make it very easy for people to look at what is there, what exists, what are the statements of all these organizations. And about organizations, we have worked very hard to try to make it a generic concept that is something that you can somehow specialize. There's a lot of parameters that you can set, right? So you can specialize into something that we will call a nation or a city or a corporation that has some, you know, financial interests, or a gang of pirates that is more based on anarchy, for example. So we've tried to, you know, understand what are the general principles connecting all these different things and made this concept of organization that you can specialize into these different types of political structures, basically. That's the idea. So it's all about organization. If you go, we just started a website, a community website. It's called community.jewelthegame.com. Where people can already start now to create a character. I mean, just state the character and put a picture. And more importantly, they can create organizations and start to recruit. And it's amazing. There are already more than 230 organizations that have been created. Some of them have more than 60 members. I mean, it's pretty amazing. This is something we really want to push. This is the core idea. Creating groups of people, setting goals for themselves, recruiting, trying to attract the new players to their cause. Let's build a Death Star, right? That could be an organization. I didn't look at all of them, but maybe there's already one that has set this goal, right? Maybe.
Oh, I'm sure that goal's out there. I'm sure it's going to happen. It may take time.
But there won't be any Death Star planet annihilating raid. I have to say that, because that would be really too much punishing for the people on that planet.
Right.
I mean, you're playing the game, you're making your little castle, and suddenly one morning, blah, the planet is gone.
Right.
This is too bad. We can't get that done.
No, okay. I know. I'm just saying. I think that's probably in someone's idea or dream at some point, is to just try and do something as that large. Obviously, there's mechanics where you can't quite be that terrible to people who spend their time in the game.
And we have also, I mean, about destruction, about the thing that you can lose your ship or things. There will never be any destruction of information. That is, if you have a ship, there will be snapshots automatically taken. That will allow you, provided you have the necessary resources. So it will cost you money in game or time, but it will be able to rebuild this ship as it was. So there will never be any loss of information. But the more important thing is that, the efforts you've put over all these weekends to create this beautiful castle, this will never be lost. The only thing is that you may have to pay to acquire the materials, right, so that you can rebuild it automatically with a repair unit.
Okay. So this question here says, how diverse will the planets be? Will they all look like Earth, or will there be cool alien planets as well?
There will be cool alien planets as well.
Okay.
It's just, so we call this, it's technically, it's called a biome. It's just a set of, you know, assets that describe the kind of things you can encounter in a certain region. So we have forest biomes, we have plains biomes, mountain biomes, and we have desert biomes so far. So that's what we have. We are going to develop more alien biomes to encounter things that are surprising. So far, they are all made by the artists we have, so we cannot do everything immediately. It takes time. But the plan is that we release continuously, you know, as we go. You know, this game is not going to ship and that's it, goodbye. It's an MMO, so it's going to, hopefully, if the community is supporting us, if we have lots of people in the game, if it's a commercial success, it will last for several years, maybe many years, 10 years, I don't know. So over those years, we are going to continually add more things, so in particular, add more biomes. And the idea I have is that the strangest things you could encounter will be further and further away from the object. That gives a motivation for explorator to actually go further and further away And so as you explore further and further away, that takes time, and it gives us time actually as a company, you know, to develop more and more interesting content that you will find on the fringe of the known universe as you keep exploring.
Okay. So now, will there be any procedurally generated ships, stations, or structures?
No.
Okay, so everything's going to be built by us.
That's the key idea. I think, you know, if you generate procedurally things, it's completely fine for a single player that you play for maybe 10, 20, 30 hours. But if you consider, again, what I just said, I mean, this game could last for 10 years. After 10 years, you will have seen it all. It will be a bit like the same thing that gets always, you know, recycled somehow. It's very hard, and now, you know, it's the guy specialized in AI who's speaking. It's very hard to have creativity in machines and make things really surprising and interesting out of pure algorithms. So there's a limit to how far you can go in generating procedural content. If you consider very long periods of time where people will basically have seen it all. So our vision is really that the content should be created by the players themselves. And we believe that ultimately, because of that, the quality of the content will be much greater than anything any company with any financial support will ever be able to do. Because it's the collective activity of maybe hundreds of thousands of people that you will be able to experience in the game. And with the economy in the game, you get a selection process. The nicest things will get selected by people buying it, basically. And the ugly and not nice or not working things will just vanish because nobody buys them. And they just don't exist in the economy. And this is the same thing in the real world economy, if you think about it, right?
Right.
So we have hopes that in the long run, there will be an amazing amount of quality content that will emerge in the game on average. So it doesn't prevent you from finding some really ugly shit or ugly stuff from time to time around, right? But this should not be the majority, I suppose, because, you know, you want to fly in a nice ship. So if you have a choice, if you want to buy a ship, supposedly you don't build it yourself, if you want to buy one, you're going to pick a really nice looking ship, right?
Sure. So, well, at least I would, I guess, yeah.
And you can customize it afterwards. Add your personal touch to it. You know, change some parts, add some rooms, remove some things. We're thinking about, in the long run, you know, having also the possibility to sell this difference, this little add-on that you've made to an existing ship that you bought on the market. This should be something you're able to sell as an add-on, you see? So you could buy the Falcon X25, which is a famous ship that everybody buys, and you buy the add-on made by GrayStillPlays. That actually adds some super nice feature to it. And you see, and you combine those two things.
All right, yeah, I think my ship is going to be the floating bathtub. My skills at crafting, definitely not too advanced yet.
If it's your ship and you like it and you have this personal relation to it, you know, it's your ship, it's fine. It's completely fine.
Now, this question here says, how will the game handle griefers and trolls? And it says what they mean by that is if you create a magnificent build, so that's your castle or your amazing ship, and you go offline and someone has a giant fleet and destroys you overnight, will there be any way to stop that?
Okay, so there are lots of things to say about that because there's not one single mechanism that will answer or respond to that concern. It's a concern. We are not aiming for free for all PvP. It's Mad Max, and you know, and basically, you know, as soon as you enter the game, you're going to be sniped.
Right.
No, we want to have a right balance between areas that we call safe zones. The first safe zone will be around the Ark ship. It's going to be about 20 kilometers wide. Safe zones where basically nothing bad can happen to you. No weapon can fire, no one can steal your stuff, and it's completely safe. That's hence the name. You know? Then there is this idea that you could unlock more safe zones on other planets by exploration, finding some artifacts or things that would be on these planets in certain areas that are completely random positioned. So you cannot use this as a strategic way to, you know, create a safe zone around a war area. You just don't know where they're going to be. And so you will have several safe zones in the game that will actually allow you to build stuff peacefully. And you will have to actually secure territory, most likely, into these safe zones. That will be a big strategic thing to actually get those territories. But that's one answer. Okay, so there's other answers, which I gave, which is that you never lose information. You have those snapshots that are taken automatically that will allow you to rebuild with a repair unit, to rebuild whatever construct you have made if it's destroyed or if it's partially damaged. As long as you provide the right materials and the right energy to do it. There are other answers also is that, you know, you could be living hidden. We think that some people would just dig 1 kilometer below the surface and hide themselves over there. So things like that are also possibilities to be relatively quiet. And finally, it's probably not finally, there would be more stuff, but the last thing I'm thinking about is the fact that you will be able to create some protection bubbles if you if you have enough energy to power them. They will not be impossible to destroy, but they could be very hard to destroy. So this would be a way for people to actually secure their assets with these protection shields. That would cost a lot of money, that would cost a lot of energy. So that would presumably motivate people to actually gather into huge space stations or huge cities and finance the need for this protection bubble together so that it's not so expensive with things basically like taxes, you know, that you pay to actually support the protection bubble.
Okay.
So you see, there are lots of answers, but definitely when you enter the game, you will not be attacked. You will be in a safe zone that will be protecting you.
Okay, so now it says here, will there be NPCs and creatures in the game? If so, what kind? Obviously, I guess everyone wants to know about their potential for space whales or something. How about this here?
we don't know if we will have the resources to have this in the game as it launches. That is animals on the planets and things that you can hunt or that could actually attack you. I think we need that. I think it's a very good idea. It's actually a fairly obvious idea. But it's kind of expensive to make because you have to make all these animations, you have to create all this content, and we have limited resources. So the short answer is that we can't promise anything, but in principle, there should be NPCs, animals, not people. People are, if you meet someone in the game, it's a player. But NPC animals would be good. About the whales in space, why not?
Okay.
Why not?
Actually, it's good to hear that there are possibilities. Yes.
There's a possibility. You know, one thing I want to say to everybody who is listening or still listening after 1 hour is that we really want to discuss with our community and to listen to what people want. We do that in an informal way at the moment on the forums, but we may actually make things to let people sort of vote, or I don't know if that's the right way to do it, but you know what I mean, to get people to express their preferences. So I don't know, for example, if people really want whales in space, we would like to hear it and put it on top of our to-do list, basically. We still control the to-do list because there are constraints, you know, about development, about things. So that's the trick. I mean, we cannot just let people decide in what order we do things because there are a lot of constraints that are hard to explain or that are just unknown to people. But we would like to have the roadmap strongly influenced by what people really want.
Okay, so now it says here, will there be crafts and vehicles besides spaceships, such as land crafts and underwater crafts?
Okay, so the way we see land craft for the moment is that it's going to be like a hovercrafts, things that, that basically are ships that cannot fly high, but that will actually, you know, fly, let's say, 1 meter above the ground. We have no plan yet for wheeled vehicles on planets. I think there are some technical issues with that. So that's not sure we will have that. And for underwater vehicles, it's the same thing. We have not given thought to it at the moment. But it could be done, of course. It would be very nice. It would be very nice to have submarines and things like that. It's clearly on the to-do list. At some point, we will look at that, but it's not in the priorities. So far, what we will have is ships and hovercrafts to travel on the planet, and also walking. You can walk, so that's perfectly fine. We will actually make it not free to travel with a ship or with a hovercraft, actually. So you have to finance the fuel for it. You have to, there's energy concerns and things like that. So for small distances, walking should be the preferred and natural way to deal with distance.
Okay. I know we're coming up on an hour here that you and I have been talking about these different questions. So there's just a few questions that are kind of maybe just yes or no questions. I want to get at least some of those out of the way to try and, I had a lot of questions coming from the community.
Of course. So I'm going to be short. Let's go.
So let's do it. Here we go. Will there be cosmic phenomena like black holes?
No, not yet. We have no plan for that for the moment. But it's a cool idea. We would love to think about it.
All right. Will there be items that players can equip, like weapons, armor, and utility items?
Yes, definitely yes. And you can craft them.
Will there be multiple arc ships?
Unlikely, because that would divide the community. So far the plan is that you have only one.
Okay. Will there be a way for you to continue to build on a ship that's mobile? In other words, a mobile command station or a mobile base?
Absolutely. There is no limitation on the fact that the ship is moving. You can have 100 people on the ship and the ship is moving and that's fine. You can build on it. I mean, there's no problem attached to the fact that the ship is moving or in movement. No problem.
If you destroy terrain, what sort of physics-based repercussions will it have? Will flowing water go in different ways? Will caves collapse?
No flowing water. This is a very difficult problem when you have planet-sized stars. Imagine a huge, mountain with a lake on top, and you dig a little hole at the bottom. You can imagine the engineering problem going on. So we may have local water flow at some point that basically stops when you go further away. About the destruction of, if you cut a mountain underneath, it will still float in the air. Again, for the same reasons, because calculating disconnections of areas on large scales would simply be not practical. And I don't think it brings anything really fundamentally interesting in the gameplay. So we won't have that.
Okay. Will there be other multiple playable races besides humans?
No.
Okay. That's fine.
No, it's a story of mankind rebuilding civilization, as I said, together on a new planet. So no.
Okay, that's awesome. So we managed to get rid of all of the yes or no questions. So this is kind of the one, I'm going to leave with, and this may take a little bit more explanation for this one. And it says, basically, how, considering all of the crafting and all of the items that can be built, the structures and the cities and everything, is there a way, or how, what are your plans for any kind of performance issues that maybe other games have had? How do you plan on people being able to render those types of things and being able to play the game and the stability of the game itself with all those objects?
Okay, so the answer to that is that from the start, the architecture of everything we have done was made with the idea that you could have huge things. So we use things that are very classical, actually, called level of details, which I think other games don't necessarily use, as far as I understand, so that you have a degradation of the quality of the visual quality of things when you look to them from a distance. You know, the further you look, the less detailed they are, basically. So that allows us to maintain a standard level of load of CPU or graphic rendering, no matter how big or large stuff are. So in principle, this should work. Now we didn't test, you know, with ten thousands of ships with 50,000 people moving. I mean, in principle, in the mathematical models that we have and the testing we have done so far, everything works. So the final answer will be when the game starts and when the players are in game. So that will be the final test. But all our testing so far have been working. The way we test is that we rent machines on Amazon and we spawn sort of virtual clients of them so that we can attack our server and test the load in this way. So on the server technology and on the rendering technology, everything we have done has been made with that idea in mind and on purpose has been designed to be able to withstand a heavy load. So that's all I can say at the moment.
Okay. Well, you know, that's pretty much it, man. I think we've covered all the questions for the most part. And I really appreciate, again, just the time and the detail that you went into in a lot of these questions because there's some selfishness from me here. I had a lot of these same questions. I was very interested about them. And it was just cool to finally be able to get some of that really detailed, interesting answers on them. So I just wanted to say thank you for your time to take the time to answer these questions from the community. We all really appreciate that.
You're most welcome. I really enjoy it. And I want to say again, we want to exchange with the community. We want to have discussions like that. It's really, really nice. We appreciate all the feedback. I encourage people. I know it's a lot of text, but anyway, you go on the dev blog, you know, devblog.jewelthegame.com. There are a lot of things that have been written describing a lot of things we have been discussing here, like the resurrection nodes, the economy, the voxel building, the organizations, and so on and so on. So for people who really want to dig into what is Dual Universe, there is a lot of material that you can access right now going on this dev blog, going on the website. And for everything that is missing, we're going to publish more things. And I really enjoy having these discussions with you, being able to explain what we have in mind and when Dual Universe is going to be released.
Okay.
Thank you.
Fantastic. I'm going to go ahead and put those links in the description below so that everyone can be able to access those links. Again, JC, thank you for your time. I know that you obviously have some probably important things to do, so I'll let you get going. And that's going to be it for now, guys. Is there anything else that you'd like to say before we go ahead and end it here?
Well, thank you again for having me. And just keep an eye on the newsletter, the Facebook, Twitter, and all our community tools that we have. We communicate a lot. We want the feedback, as I said. So that's it. Just join us in discussions.
All right. Well, everyone, hope you enjoyed this little communication and interview with JC. Until the next time, stay foxy and much love.